we're doing, guys, all right? We're back on the trail of the Yorkshire Ripper. And today, I thought I would take you to three unique spots in the story. I think they're quite fascinating aspects of the Yorkshire Ripper story. It involves the arrest and confession. It involves the circumstances around the arrest. And it also focuses on the subsequent trial that would take place in London. And so with that in mind, we're going to go to our first stop, which is Dewsbury.
You can see the magnificent Dewsbury Town Hall, where the Yorkshire Ripper made his first public appearance. This is the route that the police van would have taken on January 5th, 1981, around about 5 p.m. Came up the side of Dewsbury Town Hall and turned to go round the back of it. You can see already 2,000 people had gathered, some holding placards and waving nooses. You can imagine the hostility. Some threw stones and pebbles. As the van turned around, it made its way to the middle of the building where other officers were waiting at the open doors.
So, as Sutcliffe was brought through these doors, through the hallway and into the courtroom, you had the clerk of the court, Mr. Dean Gardner, and he addressed the court by saying, "Peter William Sutcliffe, you are charged with the murder of Jacqueline Hill and the theft of car license plates from Mr. Cyril Bamforth worth 50p. Sutcliffe was taken back to Armley. He appeared again at Dewsbury Town Hall. This time on 20th of February, he was charged with 13 murders and 7 attacks. So the almost a full catalogue of the Yorkshire Ripper murders. But he had plenty of time to sit there in prison and think about what he had done, of course. And he was then being assessed by the medical experts. Time, three experts done an assessment on, the most famous which the Dr. Milne, who wrote a 35-page analysis of Sutcliffe, his early life, his thoughts, his marriage, anything that could have compelled him to have become the Yorkshire Ripper. During this time, hundreds of reporters had descended upon Garden Lane in Bradford, so much so the residents of Garden Lane petitioned the council to actually close the street, saying they couldn't sleep at night. People were coming around, knocking on doors. At one point, Sonia Peter's house, should I say, at 6 Garden Lane, was actually set on fire. Somebody came along in the middle of the night, broke the windows, threw a kind of petrol bomb into the living room, and it caused over £1,000 worth of damage. Lucky enough, two police officers who were looking after the property, well, not very well, managed to put the fire out, so no damage was done. Sonia, understandably, wasn't in the house. She had escaped to the comfort or sanctuary of her parents' house over in Clayton, and she wouldn't be seen again until the actual trial down at the Old Bailey. So we're back in the car again, and this time we're heading over to a little scrapyard just outside Mirfield, and some of you may know what I'm about to talk about. Interesting part on the trail of the Yorkshire Ripper. We're here at an old scrapyard in Cooper Bridge, just outside Mirfield, not too far from Dewsbury, where we've just been earlier on. And it's here that plays a significant role in how the Yorkshire Ripper was captured. So, as you can see, this is a place where cars still come to die. Not where I stopped my van. Anyway, so we know about the Yorkshire Ripper being caught in Sheffield. We know about the two officers turning up at the scene where he was with Olivia Reavers in his car. And we know that the officers found the license plates on his car were false. When they checked his car, they found the license plates were actually addressed to a Mr. Khan, and who owned a Skoda. Looking at Sutcliffe's Rover, they realized these plates are wrong. They tore them off and realized they'd been stuck on by sellotape. But it was this here scrapyard is where Sutcliffe went to get the license plates off that Skoda to put on his own car. What's interesting is that the workers and all who still work here at the Motor Hog, I think it's a Motor Hog scrapyard actually, where car sales and car parts, they all know the story. They all still know the story, they still tell it well. And when I arrived here, I give the usual, you might not have heard this, and they did. They told me all about it, and it's a routine kind of lesson that every young employee who comes here gets to know, that this was the scrapyard in which the Yorkshire Ripper stole the license plates, which eventually led to his arrest in Sheffield. Fascinating place. By the time it came to the Old Bailey, Sutcliffe's reason for committing the murder had changed. He was now saying he was on a divine mission. In other words, God had instructed him to kill all prostitutes. And before I tell you any more about that, let me take you to the actual place where Sutcliffe said this divine mission first began. Hi guys, how are we doing? Right, so we're here now in Bingley Cemetery, and this is arguably the most important part of the early days of the Yorkshire Ripper, because it would first give us the inclination of what he was like, what went through his brain as a younger person, but also it would then come back later on at his trial down the Old Bailey. Behind me, we have the grave of Bronislaw Sapolsky. And you may be thinking, what's this got to do with Peter Sutcliffe, the Yorkshire Ripper? Well, it was from this grave that Sutcliffe claimed to have heard a divine voice, almost like the voice of God or voice of Jesus, that he would later use as an excuse for his divine mission to go out and rid the world of prostitutes. So, Sutcliffe had two spells of work here in Bingley Cemetery. The first was around 1964. It was short-lived, and he was sacked for bad timekeeping, according to the boss, Douglas McTavish. He went off and worked for the water board, but then around about June 1965, he was re-employed back as a gravedigger here. Now, June 1965 is an interesting year, and I'll explain a bit more later on. It's something I noticed the other day. In his time here as a gravedigger, there was lots of rumours floating about that Sutcliffe, as a young guy, would be interested and fascinated with dead bodies. Often, some of his work colleagues would say, when a funeral had left, he would jump into the grave, open the graves up, and take out the rings, or sometimes the gold fillings, of the corpses that lay inside. Other times down the pub, he would openly brag about being in the graveyard, hooking through bodies, and on some occasions would pull out of his pocket some rings. He would offer them for sale in the pub. Where did he get these rings? Probably obvious. He was stealing them off the dead corpses.
When it came to Sutcliffe's trial at the Old Bailey, he claimed he had heard the voice of God at a gravestone in Bingley Cemetery. He said he was digging a grave at the bottom section of the Roman Catholic area. He heard a voice, not too dissimilar from a human voice. It was all jumbled up on top of each other. It sounded like echoes. He climbed out of the grave. He looked around. He couldn't see where the sound was coming from. So he walked up towards the hill and he heard the sound again. He went over and was transfixed on a certain spot, a gravestone with a statue of Christ upon it. The name, a Polish man called Sapolsky. He said from this point he heard the voice of God. Later, he would claim this voice guided him on a mission to rid the world of prostitutes. The defence argued that this was a clear sign that Peter Sutcliffe was suffering from paranoid schizophrenia. The prosecution, however, would argue against this, saying that Sutcliffe was simply making this story up.
Now, I said earlier that 1965, particularly June, was of great significance to the story of Peter Sutcliffe. This was his second spell back at the graveyard. And at his trial, he was able to name the headstone of Bronislaw Sapolsky. He told where it was, whereabouts in the cemetery he had been, and many thought, well, how could he know the details of one particular gravestone so well unless something did actually happen? Well, this might answer the question. If we look at the bottom of this gravestone, it does say Bronislaw Sapolsky died 19th of June 1965. The same month and the same year that Sutcliffe came back to work here at the cemetery, so in all likelihood, he probably dug this very grave, the grave we're standing at now. He remembers digging it, he probably remembers staring at it, he remembers the Jesus cross, and who knows what else he remembers about this particular grave. Did he perchance steal from this grave? And that's why he knows it so well. It's an interesting possibility. Another interesting part of the story is one of the work colleagues who worked with Sutcliffe said that he had a habit of digging down into the grave for fresh graves, finding old bones, and he'd pull up the skull and and some of the arms, and he kind of put them on a stick, and he'd scare the girls from the nearby Bingley Grammar School, which happens to be within sight of the actual grave over there. Looking straight across, and it's just right there. There's the old wall next to the school. If you look down there, you'll see the old wall where he would have hid behind the wall and then poked a skull above to scare the schoolgirls as they made their way past. So, that was Bingley Cemetery and the story of how Peter Sutcliffe used a gravestone at a time he was digging here to claim a divine mission that sent him out to kill prostitutes. And whether you believe his story or not, it still remains a fascinating part on the trail of the Yorkshire Ripper.